Good morning, everybody.
I told y'all I was doing a lot of firsts, right? This is my all black coffee. If you don't believe me, check it out. All black coffee. One of these, I'm good. So today I'm gonna tackle cleaning my house. So I'm gonna be gone for a lot of the day, meaning not on this vlog, right? But then I'm gonna come back in the evening time for a word of encouragement for you. So stay tuned, keep watching this video. If you don't, well, I don't have anything to say, but yeah, just do it, right? What's that?
Oh, that's grits.
I just had grits and egg. If you don't know what grits is, Google it. I'll see you guys later. Okay. Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So I got three chocolates here ready for this video. First we're gonna start with Twix. That's it. I hope I know chocolate on my teeth. If chocolate on my teeth, don't judge me because I can't see. So have you ever tried to present the gospel to someone and then they're just like, thanks but no thanks? So guys, I'm about to read you a story from Mark 10 verses 17. It's also in Matthew 19 and Luke 18. And it reads, Jesus counsels the rich young ruler. Now as he was going out on the road, one came running, knelt before him and asked him, good teacher, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? So Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, and that is God. I'll stop right there. Even I used to be like super confused when I read that verse because I was like, but Jesus, aren't you one with God? Like, it almost sounds like he's saying, don't call me good because the only good one is God. But when you read it properly, and this is also how I know the Holy Spirit speaks, because as I was studying the scripture, I was praying and asking God for him to just reveal to me what this truly meant. And exactly the conclusion I came up is exactly the same conclusion that came up when I researched it from Bible scholars. So basically, when Jesus is saying this, in other words, Jesus is saying, why would you call me good unless you mean to say that I am one with God? Because the only one who is worthy to be called good is God. Mind you, throughout his ministry, Jesus never denied his oneness with God the Father. He never denied that he was the Son of God. In fact, that's exactly why the Pharisees hated him and sought to kill him, because they considered it blasphemy. So when Jesus is saying this to the young ruler, are you sure you know what you're saying? Because by you calling me the good teacher, you're agreeing that I am the Son of God. You basically saying that you understand what's up. So he continues, you know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and your mother. And he answered and said to him, teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth. Then Jesus said, looking at him, loved him. I never saw that detail. Loved him. This is intimate. So this is what Jesus says, one thing you lack, go your way, sell whatever you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross and follow me. But he was sad at this word and went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Now, when I researched this story, I found that this guy was basically a really, really rich dude. He was a ruler, so that's why they call him the rich young ruler. But still, with all that wealth, he was looking for something. So he goes on his knees to Jesus and says, good teacher, what do I need to do to go to heaven? That background alone is super interesting, because you're telling me you could have a great title and you can have all the wealth, but there's still this God-sized hole in your heart, this heaven-sized hole in your heart that's just like, I have all this stuff, but what do I need to do to go to heaven though? So Jesus tells him, he looks at him. This is so intimate. He questions this man's theology. You call me good teacher. Do you know what you're saying by calling me that? Because the only one who deserves to be called good is God. And that I think was a really important step, because just like when we share the gospel, obviously, in order to accept the gospel, the good news, you have to accept that Jesus is the Son of God. So before Jesus even got into commandments and sell your wealth, he wanted to make sure, what do you call me? And this is the same question that Jesus had asked his disciples. He said, what do others call me? And then Peter, who had his own revelation, said, well, you're the Son of God. And that's when Jesus looked at him and said, Peter, you're going to be the rock that I build my church on, because flesh never told you that. So then Jesus responds and he's just like, well, you got to do the 10 commandments. You got to do this, 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 and this. The man says, well, I've been doing that since I was a kid. And that's so crazy, because right now Jesus, with what he's about to say, is about to make the distinction between relationship and religion. The fact that you can do all those things and still not get to heaven. It's so beautiful. The Bible says that Jesus looked at him, loved him, and then said, one thing you lack. Crazy. Like, when you read that, Jesus looked at him, loved him. The Bible never needed to include those details. It could have just said that Jesus answered him and said, yeah, well, you could just do this other thing. But the eyewitness records that Jesus looked at him and loved him. Before he said anything, he looked at him and loved him. So when we're trying to present the gospel, we need to first make sure that before we open up our mouth, we are looking at that person and we are loving that person. That is so important. Because a lot of us here think we're doing work for the kingdom, when really we're just trying to win souls, as if we're in some race or some hunt. And the one with the most souls in their bag wins. That's not how this works, guys, in the kingdom. If you're trying to compete with other saints to try to get souls for you, for Jesus, but really it's actually for you, that ain't how this thing works. You gotta make sure you're looking at this person. Do you even know this person's first name? Do you understand where they're coming from? Why they think the way they think? What background they come from? What country they come from? Maybe if they was abused as a child from a pastor, and maybe that's why they left God. Before you go trying to convert people, you need to make sure that you know the people. And then Jesus gives such an important instruction. He says, fine, you did all that. Go your way, sell whatever you have, and give it to the poor. That's the first thing. Now remember now, any instruction or calling that God gives us never comes without a promise. So he says, and you will have treasure in heaven. Second thing, come, take up the cross, and follow me. You did the Ten Commandments, great and cool. Now can you give up your life to follow me? In this particular section, wisdom is very important, because this doesn't mean that every rich person in the world who wants to be a Christian needs to sell everything they have, take up a symbolic cross, and follow Jesus. I think in this particular case, especially when you read the last verse, that the man was sad at this word and went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions, you would realize that Jesus, already knowing this man's heart, knew that wealth and probably title, because he was a rich young ruler, was like this man's heart, kind of like this man's idol. Really, what would have been a sacrifice for this man and a demonstration of his heart for Jesus and his heart for God and his heart for ministry would have been selling his possessions to give to the poor and then taking up the cross to follow Jesus. So the wisdom that needs to be had is not that if you're rich, just sell everything and then do something else. No, God uses wealthy people all the time. And in fact, he raises up people to be wealthy so that he can use them to expand his kingdom. But it's context. This particular man, his particular heart was a heart that loved wealth. We know that because he walked away sad, because the Bible said, for he had great possessions. In other words, he was not willing to lose his possessions, give them away, in fact, to follow Jesus. Let me tell you the mind-blowing revelation I got from reading this. Couple things, but I'll just say the bigger balloon here. If heaven is to be had by anyone, it has to be chosen. I'll say it again. If heaven is to be had, it has to be chosen. The same way God doesn't force anyone into hell, he doesn't force anyone into heaven. And the next revelation I had was the humility of Jesus. When I think of us as Christians trying to spread the gospel, it's true. We get a burden for people and their soul. We feel like we have to do everything in our power to make sure that they get saved. But if you realize, the one on whom our faith is founded, the good news was in front of this man, and the man walked away. What does that tell us? Expect that people are going to walk away from the gospel, even if truth is looking at them in their face. Here's the next thing. Jesus didn't call him back. I had read this parable all my life, but a couple of weeks ago, it hit me. I was like, wait, Jesus, why didn't you call him back? Why didn't you chase after him? Why didn't you say, hey, you don't know what you're doing. I promise you, I'm the Son of God. You don't know. Do you know what the stakes are if you don't trust Jesus with your life, if you don't receive salvation? That means heaven isn't your eternal home, because heaven is Jesus' residence. So if you don't accept Jesus, how do you expect to abide in his residence, right? So my thing is, Jesus, knowing this, did not call that man back. And again, wisdom is to be had here. God is a God who chases us. We know that. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. There are many testimonies tied to the fact that God is a God who chases after you. However, God is also a God who is all-knowing. When Jesus looked at him, he knew this man's heart. So Jesus knew within himself, your heart is not going to be a heart that chooses me. That's why I asked you to give up your wealth. That question was the test. If you said yes, I know that your heart is for me, and therefore you would follow me. But if you said no, your heart is not for me. Basically, Jesus is like, why would I follow after you to call you back if I know wealth is too much in your heart?
Is that you down there?
What?
I'm filming. Oh, no, it's fine.
Okay.
I will.
You ask me? Johnny, I'll take it out of you.
No.
Soon be there.
Nobody.
Why are you in bed with them?
Well, maybe he fed them when I wasn't there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he inside there.
Yeah, he probably did.
What was I saying? So,
You got to have that piece of it.
What was I going to say?
You want to go by the coffee shop? You don't know. They close it.
No, but I was supposed to call Wilnique at 5 o'clock.
Oh, cool. You don't have to ride anyway.
What was I saying, guys? Oof, that was good too. Oh, I was just talking about how, like, it's crazy that Jesus himself did not chase this man down because he knew his heart. It's as simple as that. There are some people who will never choose God and they will have the truth in their face. It ain't that the truth is distorted. They will have the truth in their face and they will still reject it. They will still say no. Think on Jesus's position at this point. He is the gospel. He is the good news. He is the way, the life, and the truth. And even he didn't chase after this man because he knew his heart. And what does Jesus say in the Bible? He says, those who save their life will lose it. And those who give up their life for my sake shall save it. And a lot of times we ask, well, God, why do you require me to give up my life? And I think that it's all about the throne on our hearts. It's like God wants to say, you have a life. You obviously have things you like, you're passionate about, and all those things. But do I sit on the throne in your heart? Am I the foundation on which you stand? If I'm not, it's so easy for everything else in life to come before me in your heart. And that's not going to work. Because God, above all else, requires relationship. It's the why of our creation. It's the why of Jesus coming down. All of it is because of love and because of relationship with us. So that's a revelation I had. Then I thought about the fact, well, why was this man sad? Like, if you're going to leave, leave. Like, if you're going to reject, reject, right? But if it was your decision to make, why are you sad about it? Like, why are you sad about it, though? And I was sitting here, and even now I was like, God, like, why was this man sad about it? And you know what I just realized? Remember that question that I asked in the very first Vlogmas? I got it from a man who does apologetics. And he said, you know, when you're sharing the gospel and you want to understand someone's hindrance to faith, hindrance to Jesus, just ask them, if Christianity were true, would you become a Christian? And he said in his experience, in his many years of going all around the United States to countless universities, so many people have stood at the mic and told him, no, even if Christianity were true, I would not become a Christian. That is exactly what you see illustrated in this parable. Truth himself was in front of this man and he went away. But why be sad about it? It means that this man's hindrance to Jesus and to salvation, it wasn't truth. It wasn't if he thought that this was true. He knelt before this man. Look at the details of the parable. This is a rich young ruler kneeling before this man, giving him respect, and then calls him good teacher. So his hindrance to faith wasn't truth. It just simply was that wealth was the idol in his heart. I believe that there are some people who will and who have walked away from the gospel, not because they didn't think it was true, but it was because their heart was too filled with other stuff that they weren't willing to let go of. And I think that's just the simple answer. It could be wrong. It could be something else. So take that with a grain of salt. But that was just my thoughts and my observations. Like, some will walk away sad. And we should learn from the story not to be surprised by that. Not to be surprised when we're trying to share the gospel and then people are like, no thanks, I'm good. It's like, oh, well, I thought the truth will set you free. Some people simply won't choose that though. And it always goes down to what I said earlier. If heaven is to be had, it has to be chosen. This is again why it's so important to read the Bible as a whole, because if you know about the story of the narrow road versus the narrow road is narrow for a reason. It's because few will choose to endure it. What does the Bible say? There is a narrow road where only few will go on. There is a broad road where many will go on. The broad road leads to destruction. The narrow road leads to life. But the narrow road is such that only few will choose to endure it. So guys, that's it for today. That's all I wanted to share. I totally also forgot to finish my other chocolates, but it's all right. I'll live. Guys, I will see you guys in tomorrow's Vlogmas. I only have 3 days left. Ah, hallelujah, God is good because this thing is hard. But I do have something super cool planned for Christmas Day. So stay tuned for that and I will see you guys tomorrow. Bye.